Hello and welcome to another Metal Methodologies podcast interview. I'm Owen Coggins, conducting a series of conversations with metal researchers about methods, theory, the practicalities of metal research, and what's going on in metal studies today. This edition is about decoloniality. With me over the internet is Dr. Nelson Varas-Diaz, professor of social community psychology at Florida International University in Miami, co-editor of Metal Music Studies Journal, and board member of the International Society for Metal Music Studies. Welcome, Nelson.
Thanks, Owen. Thanks for having me.
Okay, so let's get straight into it. Let's start with asking, what is decoloniality? Where does the idea come from, and why is it important?
Okay, so I guess the first question is always the hardest one to answer, because it's so vast of an idea, right? But maybe the best way to define it would be to start thinking, if we're going to talk about decoloniality, then we might as well start by defining coloniality before we decolonize it. So coloniality is a term coined by the Peruvian sociologist Aníbal Quijano. And he used the idea of coloniality or colonial matrix of power to kind of describe the idea that the colonial experience in the Americas that began in the 15th century is still very much present and alive today. So he was concerned in a sense with the notion that some people believe that the colonial experience ended with the independence of the colonized countries in the Americas. And he wanted to express the notion that the devaluation of local people, the devaluation of local knowledges and local experiences that emanated from the colonial experience is still alive and kicking today. So he saw that as a manifestation of power, which he termed coloniality, and that term kind of generated this whole reflection about the ongoing manifestations and consequences of colonialism still today in Latin America, and the need to kind of bring it into question and address it critically, and thus decoloniality, right? And what people have termed the decolonial option or the decolonial turn is this reflection on the effects of coloniality today and how do we address it critically.
Uh-huh. So it's quite an enormous issue. So how does decoloniality impact on metal music and culture specifically?
Well, it was interesting because most people know that I do work in Latin America, but my work began basically in Puerto Rico and the Caribbean region. And when I started doing my research on the intersection of metal and culture in the Caribbean, one of the things that people immediately wanted to talk about was the issue of colonialism. You know, how do we tackle the history of colonialism in the region? And that subject came up because I was talking to people about, you know, how does metal become a critical venture into local culture? And they were very rapidly, immediately expressed the idea that metal was critical of local culture and that local culture and oppression within local culture stemmed from the colonial era. So to me, the linkages between decoloniality and metal became evident in my work very early on. And as you continue traveling through Latin America, it becomes even more evident, right? How people use metal music to understand the colonial experience, how they use metal music to be critical of the colonial experience, and how they use metal music to intervene. To kind of set themselves free from that colonial experience. So to me, coloniality and decolonial agenda, metal in Latin America, a lot of it has a decolonial agenda because it's so critical of coloniality. So those two things to me are completely intertwined when we think about metal, in particularly in Latin America where I do research.
Uh-huh. So this your research on exactly these topics has led to a book that's coming out soon. So can you give us an overview of what that book covers?
Well, that book, I started writing that book as I made my documentaries throughout the region. So the book covers the idea of metal as a decolonial strategy in Latin America. And I provide examples from 9 countries to kind of justify why I believe that metal has become a decolonial force in the region. So in the book, I cover a theoretical approach to decoloniality and metal, but I also use examples from Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, Cuba, Mexico, Peru, Chile, Argentina, Ecuador, and Guatemala and Colombia. So nine countries in all, to kind of reflect how metal in the region has become decolonial. And I use multiple examples from, you know, metal highlighting the plight of indigenous populations, how the, you know, the colonial experience of the 15th century later turned into the dictatorships of the 19th century and the disappearance of people who resisted those dictatorships, American interventionism as part of a colonial history in the region, and the most recent kind of manifestation of coloniality in the region, which has to do with, you know, rampant neoliberal practices of extreme capitalism that has in some countries privatized even the water that we drink. So metal is very, very adept at seeing the long-lasting effects of colonialism. So it's kind of natural for it to become, to be part of the decolonial agenda. But unfortunately, as you can imagine, when people look at metal from the outside, they don't think about it as a decolonial strategy. They think about it mostly with the prejudices that we all know, you know, Satanism and noise and drugs and sex. But when you look at it in detail, you know, it's much more than that. And I think research has, you know, of course, shattered that prejudice and that myth. But
yeah, still, it can even just be understood as escapism, even if it's not bad in itself. It's often just seen as something that has no political agency.
Yeah, completely. And when you look at it from a Latin American perspective, I mean, a lot of it has that very much political agency, political decolonial agency embedded in it from the very beginning of metal music in the region. Mm-hmm.
So in terms of these kinds of questions, how did you approach it in terms of methodology and the kind of in terms of joining the actually what you did, the practicalities of research to the theoretical questions that we've been talking about?
Yeah, so when I began my research, I kind of did the things that most research do. So I did my surveys and I did my qualitative interviews, but I immediately found that the people that I was doing research with expected something much more from me than that. So they wanted products that they could use themselves. So for example, I remember one moment during my interviews in Cuba where people were saying, well, this study is very, you know, it's a very interesting, it's a great topic. So how do we read your papers? And then you start thinking to yourself, well, if you want to read a paper, you have to buy the paper from the internet, which some people don't have access to. If you're going to read a paper, you have to pay to read that paper. So there is a colonial process in academic inquiry, right? Where some people engage in academic research and just gather data from the field, and that data never goes back into the field. So
it's another kind of extractive process.
Totally. There's a lot of extractivism in academic work today. And this is not new. We know this. The challenge is, how do we break from it, right? So it seemed natural to, if you're gonna do a project about decolonial metal and you're doing it from a decolonial mindset, then how do you do decolonial methodological strategies, right? And the good thing about that was that I stopped trying to think about how to do a decolonial methodology and started asking people what they wanted from it. Mm-hmm. And the first thing that they said was, you know, we want to see the results from this study in ways that we can consume and that are both informing and entertaining. And they came up with the idea of documentary films. So my very first documentary film, when I did it, all the themes that are addressed in it had already been published in academic papers. Mm-hmm. So I had to go back and see, how do I turn these academic papers into a visual format that people can, you know, see their history on screen, enjoy it, but still be informed by the research that I'm actually doing. And that's how the documentaries came about. Because they asked for it. And I thought it was a really decolonial strategy on their behalf to kind of, you know, ask for a format that they could consume.
So now you've made The Distorted Island about metal in Puerto Rico, The Metal Islands about the Caribbean, and also Songs of Injustice about metal and the social political context in Mexico, Peru, Argentina, and Chile. So I wanted to ask, you mentioned that the ideas had maybe been already out there in an academic format, but this was a really different thing to produce. So did that give you a new perspective on some of the kind of concepts that you'd been dealing with in more traditional formats of academic literature?
It had to, because I was already trying to break free from the kind of like extractivist perspective in academic settings. I was doing things like publishing with, co-authoring with study participants. So a lot of my papers have study participants as co-authors, because they were actually in the room with me thinking about the project and thinking about the writing and how to write it up. So we had already begun to kind of crack that mindset, dividing the researcher and the research, right? Mm-hmm. But when we started doing the documentary films, that was a whole different monster, because you had to kind of de-socialize yourself from your traditional methodological training, because you're kind of trained, or I was trained to kind of think about an idea, how to put it in paper in a logical sequence, right? But when you think about that very same idea in a visual manner, people are not going to sit through a 2-hour documentary if it's not visually compelling and it's not visually entertaining and if it doesn't sound right, if the sequence doesn't flow correctly. And as researchers, we're not really trained, at least I wasn't really trained on doing that. So I had to kind of interact with other people from other fields to learn how to tell a story, my academic story, but tell it in a different way, in a more compelling way, and tell it in a way that's entertaining for people without dumbing it down, because people in these communities are very, very critical of the documentaries that you make about them. So you have to, it has to be intelligent, it has to be compelling, and it has to be entertaining. And as a researcher, you kind of have to rethink how you see research methods to allow yourself to do that.
And that has to be a good thing to kind of, even if it's challenging, to force a researcher to think about making their findings and knowledge and theories presentable in a more accessible and completely different way.
Yeah, I agree. The other thing that we've done with the documentaries that we can't do with the books, or we can't do with the publications, but we do it with the films, is that in a very decolonial manner, if you want to put it that way, we don't charge people for them. We give them away. Mm-hmm. Because we tell the universities that we work for, we tell them, you know, these are people's stories, and people shouldn't pay to see their story on film. People should get the product of the research free of charge. So one of the things that we've done is that we've disseminated the films for, you know, freely among the community, so that they have a chance to see the work that they put into the films and into the project, see it themselves without having to pay for it, which mm-hmm. I think it's interesting.
Good, and because this kind of thing involves having to think about things right, not just about data collection, but right up to the point of where knowledge is produced and accessed or not accessed, if it's behind paywalls and so on. Just before we move on, tell us what's the name of the book that's coming out, and when is it published?
My book is published it's going to be published in June 2021. It's going to be hopefully ready for the ISMS conference in Mexico, and it's titled Decolonial Metal in Latin America.
Amazing. We'll talk about the conference in a moment, but I wanted to also ask. The work that you've done, as you've been describing, has been mostly based in Latin America, which was colonized by Spain, Portugal, Britain, and France as well, and directly and indirectly by the US. But decoloniality isn't something that only applies to the areas that were colonized. It's as much a part of the condition of the colonizing, imperial, invading, exploiting nations, and it's how they arrived at their unequal position in the global system. So, and a lot of metal research takes place in Europe and North America. So how should research in those countries take decoloniality into account? Or maybe from another angle, what are the problems or shortcomings of research when those issues aren't considered?
There's quite a few answers to that question. I think the first one, let's tackle the first one first, because I think it might be useful for people doing research in the global north, right? I think one of the best explanations that I've heard about coloniality and the relation between the global north and the global south has been from the work of Boaventura de Sousa. And one of the things he argues is that the global south, when he speaks about the global south, about like the colonized spaces of the world, he says that the global south is not a geographical space, it's a metaphorical space also. Mm-hmm. So it's not only geographical, it's also metaphorical. There are pockets of the global south living in the global north. So for example, if you think about the emerging line of research on metal music with indigenous communities in Canada and in the US, those are studies that are very much about colonized people. Those are studies that are very much about the global south within the global north. So there's quite an application of decolonial theory into those spaces, right? When you think about research done from in the US or Europe on metal, but focusing on marginalized communities, ethnic communities, racial communities, communities with different genders, different sexual orientations, those are all spaces where oppression takes place, and those are all spaces where decolonial thinking has something to add. Mm-hmm. So there's utility, and there is the ability of using a decolonial approach in metal studies emerging from the global north. So that's kind of like the first part. The other part is a bit more challenging, because it has to do with the idea that if we are thinking about decoloniality and we are thinking about power relations between the north and the south, we need to examine from within metal music studies, how do we reproduce those colonial perspectives, right? So for example, the focusing on metal studies in the US and Europe and neglecting how metal studies is also emerging and quite advanced in other parts of the world, particularly in the global south, that can be an example of colonialism, of academic colonialism, right? And part of what we need to do as metal scholars is to kind of widen the gap, not only to recognize that the field is multidisciplinary and multi-regional, but actually to engage it in a multi-regional manner. And I think we've done some things in that direction. We know of research studies that are being done in different parts of the world, but unless they're published in English, they mostly fall by the wayside. Mm-hmm. And that in itself is an example of how coloniality works within the academic setting, and how it works within, it can work within metal studies, right? Mm-hmm.
So do you have any suggestions for how researchers who maybe might not have considered this dimension, how they might incorporate the kind of concept and approach to decoloniality into their research, and how kind of it might be integrated into the planning and collection of data wherever you are or whatever the topic of research?
Well, I think one thing that I think it's really important is as researchers anywhere doing research with populations who have been marginalized historically, I think it's important to think of your project in a decolonial matter, not only theoretically, but methodologically. So I have a lot of, sometimes I become really concerned about some of the research projects that kind of gather data from settings and then leave and then never go back with the data to those settings, mm-hmm. because that, as we were discussing earlier, becomes a strategy of extractivism, right? So part of what we need to do, I think, is to look for ways in which to integrate metal communities even more into the research projects that we're carrying out. But not, I don't mean integrate them solely with them giving us data. I mean integrate them into the process of, you know, giving data, collecting data, co-analyzing data, and co-publishing data. Mm-hmm. I think those are ways in which we can actually see how decolonial agendas are become alive in a research project, right? Mm-hmm. That's in the methodological component. In the theoretical component, I think part of what a lot of researchers in metal research do is they focus on the ways that metal music becomes challenging of the plight of modernity, for example. Mm-hmm. How modernity has left people behind. And metal music does that a lot. But what metal research doesn't really do too much is to understand that the modernity that metal music criticizes so much, when you move to other places of the world, looks completely different. So, for example, when Walter Mignolo says that the modernity of Europe can't happen without the coloniality of the Americas, then what happens with metal in the Americas? Metal in the Americas becomes critical of modernity, but it becomes critical of modernity through coloniality. Mm-hmm. So it's very important for researchers, in particularly metal scholars in the Global South, to use theories developed in the Global South to explain the Global South. And that is what I think the coloniality brings to the table for metal music studies, mm-hmm. at least in the Latin American component.
I think as well there can be an assumption when you're talking about ideas like oppression and particularly marginalization. There can be an assumption that since, you know, Dina Weinstein's concept of the proud pariah, which I think is really useful, metal often thinks of itself as marginalized. But that doesn't let you off the hook for thinking about people and the power relations that determine their interactions within metal. So just because metal can be marginalized doesn't mean that everybody's just a block of oppressed, marginalized people. There can be the colonial processes within metal and within the frameworks in which metal exists and operates.
And I think that's a great example of things that we kind of need to deconstruct, because when people think about metal, I see this in a lot of scholars. They say metal and they immediately think marginalization. But there are places in the world where metal is not marginalized at all. There are places in the world where metal has become a commodity for governments. It has become something to sell, something to promote tourism. So in that sense, we kind of need to break with the idea that metal is this homogeneous experience of oppression, or this homogeneous critical perspective towards oppression, and kind of look at it from the perspective of people living in different places of the world, because that changes a lot. I mean, you just have to look at the world, the work of Jeremy Wallach, or the work of Edward Banks in Africa. You know, what that type of work does is it tells you metal in these places is completely different from the metal that you're used to. It does something that's completely, it's just different, not only in its sounds and what it's singing about, it's different in how it's used by the people there.
Mm-hmm. And even the same Metallica record, works in a different way if you're listening to it in this place compared to that place, or what it means to different people. Yeah, so all of these ideas relate to the upcoming major international conference that you mentioned earlier. It's in June 2021. Can you explain what the theme of the conference is?
Yeah, the conference is theme Metal in the Global South. So this is going to be the first time that ISIMS hosts a conference, a biennial conference, in the Global South. Although, you know, so we're going to Mexico, which I think is very significant, because particularly the group that's organizing it there is led by Alfredo Nieves, who works at the National Autonomous University in Mexico, and he's been leading a seminar in Mexico City on metal music studies for a long time. So I think it's going to be an interesting meeting of the worlds between metal scholarship in the Global North and metal scholarship in the Global South. It's going to be interesting and difficult at the same time, because we are going to have, I think it's going to be the first time where we're going to have more Spanish speakers than English speakers in an ISMS mm-hmm. conference. So it has its methodological and logistical challenges, but I think it's a way for ISMS to, you know, walk the walk. Mm-hmm. We've been, you know, talking about metal studies as an interdisciplinary field, a global field, talking about global metal and culture, but we have done so at some level from the perspective of the global north. We've done so in the US and we've done so in Europe, but we've never gone to the global south. So this is, I think it's significant because it's a shift for ISMS, and I think it's doubly significant because of the thematic idea of the global south coming into discussion just lends itself to understanding that the scholarship of metal music has been alive and kicking in these places of the world, but they have not been part of ISMS until now. So I think that's going to be important.
So it's going to be a good challenge for native English speaking researchers like me to not be in the majority. It's a good challenge.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. The conference is going to have live translation between Spanish and English. So we are going to be able to communicate, but it's going to be a challenge for all of us to kind of, cross that bridge to actually be there and interact with each other in a social manner, which is just as important as the presentations too. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to be a good conference.
Great. So going back to kind of the state of metal studies research at the moment, are there any good examples of metal research that's incorporated the ideas, the methods, the theory of decoloniality, or even any examples where the aspect is really missing?
Well, I think it's definitely there. I think it's one of those things where the ideas have been pushed around in some papers, but it still hasn't been kind of coined and kind of made into a thing. So, but if you look at, for example, and I mentioned this earlier, the work in Africa by Edward Banks, that work has a strong decolonial undertone. His work in multiple African countries, it speaks about the colonial legacy there. So that's an example of what I consider decolonial work in metal studies. And if you look also at Jeremy Wallach's work in Indonesia, which he has written about from not a decolonial theoretical perspective, but he's written about it from a post-colonial theoretical approach, which are basically two different paths to the same goal, but from different regions of the world. Mm-hmm. But his work has had that post-colonial theoretical framework into it when he writes about rock and punk and metal music. So those are, you know, people who are actually doing decolonial work in geographically, right? And there's other people who have actually done decolonial work that I think is decolonial work without naming it as such. If you look at Amber Clifford's work with queerness in heavy metal music, to me, that's decolonial work. But it's not named as such. So I think it's a matter of time before the idea kind of gains ground. Uh-huh. But those works are there.
Great. And can you recommend any good texts or other resources, perhaps, maybe outside metal studies that might be a good introduction or a way further into these kind of ideas?
Yeah, I think definitely most of the work on decolonial, at least most of the work that I've read on decolonial theory or decolonial option is a lot of it is in Spanish. But if people want to read up on decolonial work in English, I think two good books to pick up would be The Dark Side of Modernity by Walter Mignolo, which I think that's a good one. And another one that's a good reader, kind of like it has multiple authors that have worked with the decolonial option. It's called Globalization and the Decolonial Option, that was published by Routledge, and it was edited by Walter Mignolo and Arturo Escobar. So those are two books that I think are good introductions to decolonial thought in Latin America. It's a good place to start.
And another great place to start, I'm going to recommend your paper, Decolonial Reflections in Latin American Metal Music, Religion, Politics, and Resistance by Nelson and Eric Morales, which is published in the journal Theologique 2019, and that can be read freely online, I believe, or at least I did, which is a great kind of perspective on the issues that we've been talking about, with a specific relationship to metal and also to religion, which I'm interested in as well.
Yeah, I appreciate that one. And just that paper that you mentioned is an example of not only us trying to push a decolonial mindset into metal studies, but also of doing metal studies in a decolonial manner, because Eric Morales, the co-author for that paper, is the singer for the band Dantesco in Puerto mm-hmm. Rico. So some of you know, we traveled together throughout Latin America for my films, and we ended up writing multiple papers together. So it's a way of integrating the metal community into the academic work that we do.
Amazing. Okay, it's been a fascinating talk. Final question is to recommend some decolonial metal. My suggestion is a band called Dishti, black metal from Sri Lanka, with a song called "Fuck the Imperialist Bastards." But I also love their long track "Meditation."
Nice title.
It's explicitly decolonial. What's your recommendation, Nelson?
Well, right now I'm editing what's going to be the fourth documentary that's coming out in December. It's called Acts of Resistance, and I've been working with a band in Ecuador who is collaborating with community organizers in this Intag zone, working against the mining companies there. And the band name is Curare. It's spelled Curare. So I would check them out, because I think that's a great example of a decolonial Latin American band. Decolonial not only in the way that it sounds, because it's integrating local instrumentation into what they do. It's decolonial in terms of their lyrics, because they're singing about things like mestizaje and singing about extractivism and singing about, you know, indigenous communities in Ecuador and their plight, their ongoing plight right now. But it's also decolonial in what they do, because it's not only about singing about this stuff. It's also about, you know, getting those bodies onto the streets and actually doing something with the communities that are facing the challenges of legal and illegal mining in Ecuador. So I think if I were to say one decolonial metal band that I would urge you to look at right now would be Curare in Ecuador.
Amazing. Thanks so much, Nelson. It's been great to talk about decoloniality today. That's about what we've got time for. I'm going to try and put references and links, if possible, on the ISMMS website. You can also check there and on the social media for news and particularly updates on the Mexico City conference. And that's about it. Thanks for listening, and see you next time.
Thanks, Owen.